Am I sitting yet?
That first chair.
Which one?
Right up here to the box. That work?
Yeah, that work.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered together here with a change of plans. I think we understand that. But I have the joyous excitement and thrill of joining together Kelly Cloud and Matt Teakill in marriage. Marriage is an honorable estate instituted by God and symbolizing the mystical union that exists between Christ and the church. It is therefore not to be entered into casually but reverently and in respect for God. And it is into this wonderful relationship that Kelly and Matt now come to become husband and wife. Let us have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. Lord, even though our plans change, we know that your plans never change. We thank you so much for Matt and for Kelly. And Father, you created them and you knew them even before the foundation of the world. You knew, Heavenly Father, that you would place within their hearts a love for each other and a love for you as well. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would bless them with you. Bless their hearts and their mind and their spirit. And Father, let them walk through life, Heavenly Father, remembering this day and this moment, but remembering that you are the ones that have brought them together. We love you and we thank you, Father, for what you've done, what you're doing, but most of all, what you're going to do in their lives. For it's in Jesus' name we ask it and we pray it. Amen. You may be seated. Who has the honor of presenting Kelly to be married to Matt?
I do.
Well, we have to rearrange things a little bit. That's okay. That's what it's all about. Wait, can you breathe, Kelly? Can you just... Is that okay?
Slightly.
There you go. That's good. Matt hadn't stopped smiling since I saw him about an hour ago. And so we're excited about this event. Now, if it had been easy, nobody would have remembered it. I mean, everybody's going to remember this one, I think.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah,
yeah,
they are.
That's going to happen.
I want to begin by thanking both of you. Matt, when you called me several months ago and asked me to do this, you said to me then, and Kelly, when we met, you said to me as well, we want to do it God's way. We want to have some time of counseling and time of being together. time of studying, because when a person says that to me, when a couple says that to me, they've made the priority not the wedding, but they've made the priority the marriage. And that's what our prayer is for you today. Yeah, whether it rains or shines or hail or whatever, that's just for a moment. But the commitment that you two are going to make today, that's for the lifetime. And both of you are certainly committed to doing that. We began the service this afternoon with, I guess, an age-old statement. Dearly beloved, we're gathered together here in the sight of God and these assembled witnesses. When you look around the room, you see the people that you've known for a very, very long time. Mad people that have been here since before you were born. They were here when you were born. They saw your first steps. Kelly, they were here when you went to school and when you were on the mountaintops and when you were in the valleys. Matt and Kelly, they celebrated when you celebrated, and they cried when you cried. And they were here for you in every single way. And so today you are surrounded by people that love you. And I want you to know that. And they have a desire. And that is for you to have the most wonderful marriage that you could ever possibly have. I stand here today in that same way. I've gotten to know you, and I love you. I just want you to know that you're a character sometimes. You know that, don't you?
Perfect in every way.
We're working on it, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
And I'll never forget, Matt, I told you this several weeks ago. As a high school senior, Sunday morning you walked down and you said, I want to accept Jesus Christ into my heart as my personal Savior and Lord. Follow Him in believer's baptism. I don't know if you know it, I've shared that many, many times with teenagers, making them realize that as they graduate from high school and go off into life, that making sure that that number one priority has been fulfilled. And so I'm here, I'm rooting for you. I want you to know that with all my heart. But I want you to know that there's somebody else here that's rooting for you as well. And that is our Lord and as our Savior, Jesus Christ. You've chosen to make Him the center of this wedding as well as the center of your marriage. But I think that we need to also begin to understand that the way that God blesses us is not always the way that we understand blessing. The Bible says, for example, in Isaiah 55, verse 8, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, and my ways are not your ways. For as high as the heavens are above, so different are my thoughts and my ways concerning you. Last Monday, I got up and I really wanted to know what God wanted me to say today. I've done gobs of wedding. Some of the people in here I've had the privilege of marrying. But I said, God, I want you to lead me to your message. If I were not standing here, and instead of if the Lord Jesus Christ were standing here, what would He be saying to you today? And so He led me to a passage of scripture that I've never used in a wedding ceremony. And the reason for that, I think, is because so many times we fail to understand what it really, really means. But if everybody here is rooting for you, and if I'm rooting for you, and if God is rooting for you, these are the words that He would say. It's in Ephesians chapter 5, beginning with verse 21. And He says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, Kelly, we don't like these next words, but I want you to hang with me for a minute, okay? Wives, submit yourselves to your own husband as you do to the Lord. I told you wouldn't come like it. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, His body, of which He is Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave up Himself for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but they fed and cared for their body just as Christ does for the church. But seldom do we really understand that in Christianity, we live what would be called an oxymoron kind of a life. I realize it's a big word, but what it means is that sometimes we have to see that life as a Christian is a contradiction to understand the ways of God and the path of God, but most of all, the blessing of God. In the world in which we live right now, it's get it and grab it and hold on to it. But I want you to listen to these words of Scripture. In order to live, we must first die. In Luke 9:24, Jesus says, "For whoever wants to save their lives will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will save it." In Luke chapter 6, verse 38, "In order to have, we must be willing to give." Jesus says, "Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you again." You get to decide the kind of life and the kind of marriage that you're going to have. Another oxymoron is, in order to be lifted up, we must be willing to be humbled. That's crazy. But James says, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up." And then, in order to have our sins cleansed and wiped away, we don't hide them, but we bring them to the light for our Lord to cleanse us and to make us complete, without judgmentalism, without condemnation, nothing more than the desire of love. 1 John, we find, he says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." About 11:30 Monday, I went out and got on my riding lawnmower, and I said, "Lord, you know, that's a tough scripture, that Ephesians chapter 5, and what does it really, really, really mean?" And as I thought about it, as I rehearsed it, the Lord just gave me a word. And boy, I thought about it all week long. And the word was to elevate. To elevate. But he begins with this word, Matt. He says, "Submit to one another in reverence for Christ." Kelly, you're not asked to submit to Matt, you're asked to submit to Christ. Matt, you're not asked to love Kelly, but you're asked to love our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When I thought about that passage and I thought about the word elevate, I looked the word up in the Greek lexicon, and it means to identify with. The word submit means to identify with and to elevate and to pick it up. It's a military word. It means that we come together in an effort to elevate one another to be the very, very best that they can be. We think about that as a biblical principle, and we come to understand that what it really says is that in Philippians 2:3, he says, "Do nothing out of ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility value one another better than yourself." You see, that's an oxymoron. We find ourselves in a political season. You could never imagine Donald Trump saying Hillary Clinton is just a whole lot better than me. Or Hillary Clinton saying the same thing about Donald Trump. It doesn't work in the world, but it works for Christ. Whenever you say to yourself, I value him more than myself. And when Matt, you look at Kelly and you say, Kelly, I value you.
That's right, you do.
Yeah. But I thought about something else as I was looking. Because in that passage, in those 13 verses of Scripture, there are two pictures that are being paraded before us. There's the picture of the Lord bringing Eve, just like you were today, to that first wedding ceremony. I just had a crazy thought. Do you realize that everybody in the world was at that wedding? Did you ever think about that?
No, I did not.
Well, there was only Adam and Eve and the Lord. But I mean, just think about it. You had a full house. And so he was thinking, he didn't say it, but he was thinking, now that's what I'm talking about. You see, there you go. There she comes. And why did that happen? Because he looked at Adam. And he saw that there was something that was missing. And he didn't want anything missing. Matt, God doesn't want anything missing from your life. And he's given you this precious, beautiful bride to journey with for the rest of your lives. And he knew also that you were going to be something that would be such an unbelievable blessing. In the Bible story, we know that Satan deceived Eve. And she took of the apple, and we know the consequences. But I want you to think about a scenario. Adam hadn't taken the apple yet. Adam hadn't sinned, but he had a choice, you see. He could live separated because she would have to go, and he could stay. There was no reason for him to do it, except that out of the very depths of his love, he was willing to be cast out of that garden so that he could be with the one that he loved so very, very desperately. The Bible reminds us that to humble ourselves is a principle. But the Bible also reminds us that it is a divine power. In 1 Corinthians 13, love always protects, love always trusts, love always hopes, love always perseveres. But here's the power. Love never fails. It never fails. It stands the test of time. When we refuse to be conceited, we refuse to demand our own way, we instead look for the elevation of the other in life. And when God looks down from heaven and he sees the brokenness of both of you and the desire that you have to bless the other, he smiles because he knows that that is the marriage and the relationship that he can bless. But then lastly and finally, there's a promise. For in Ephesians 5:27, to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain, without wrinkle, without blemish, without holy, blameless. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You see, there is a glorious promise that Paul writes, Matt, and he says, husbands, love yourselves as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her, to cherish her, to protect her, to love her. And then Paul says this crazy thing. He says, no man ever hated his own body. She's your body. You're his body. You don't hurt your own body. If you remember the first week we're together, I gave you an illustration. I said, let's assume that you have a house and you build a house, and that house has 100,000 boards in it. Remember what I was talking about? Mm-hmm. And I said, every single day of your life from now to the end of your life, you can choose. Whether you build up that body or whether you tear down that body. Every ounce of judgmentalism or jealousy or pride or arrogance, you rip out a board, you rip out another board, you rip out another board. And the first half a dozen boards probably doesn't make that much difference. Maybe the first 100 boards don't make that much difference. But all of a sudden you walk in one day and you say, you know, I'm not very comfortable in this house anymore. It's not what I want it to be. And the answer is that, what did you do with the boards? But you can come in every single day and you can love your wife. You can honor and respect your husband. And boy, what that thing was to begin with was good. But what that thing becomes in the years and the years afterwards is the biggest mansion. Because of the joy and the love and the excitement and the journey. You're not going to be the same married to this woman, I tell you that right now. You better get your rubber skates on, everybody, because it's coming. And you're not going to be the same either, Kelly, because he loves you. And he's going to be there for you, because that's the kind of person that he is. I want to ask you a question, Matt. Do you promise to elevate your wife for the days of your life? Do you promise to take her as your wife, to love her and honor her and respect her, better or worse, rich or poor, sickness and in health, for as long as you both shall live?
Yes, I do.
Kelly, I want to ask you same question, pretty simple. Are you willing to elevate Matt as your husband? Are you willing to honor him and respect him and love him for better, for worse, for richer or poorer, in sickness and health, for as long as you both shall live?
Yes, I do.
But Lord, remind them of your commitment to them as well. And Lord, bless them and walk with them and guide them and direct them in every single way. In Jesus' name we ask it and we pray it. Amen.
Amen.
Matt and Kelly, boy, it's been a joy. It's been a wonderful, wonderful time. Not just today, but the last 4, 5, 6 weeks that we've been able to spend together. Sometimes we laughed, sometimes we cried, sometimes we disagreed. And whatever you do, do not go hunting in the morning. You understand that?
Don't you do it.
As your semi-pastor, don't go hunting in the morning. But it is my great privilege, under the laws of the state of Texas, as a minister of the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to now pronounce that you are husband and wife. You may kiss your bride. And now I pronounce to you, Mr. and Mrs. Matt Hill, what God has joined together, let not man with the same.
Thank you.